Dear FMX community, welcome to the 8th show of highlights of FMX 1994 to 2020. With this program, Film Academy's Animationsinstitut wants to bridge the time until we can all meet again physically by presenting outstanding speakers from the history of FMX to you. My name is Volker Helzle. I run the research department at Animationsinstitut of Film Academy Baden-Württemberg, and I will be your host for this night's show. It's great to have you with us today. For those using the interactive platform, we have turned off your microphones to avoid background noise, but you can use the chat function on the lower right side of the screen to ask questions, and we'll do our best to pass them to our guest. So we are especially happy that Sven Martin, the godfather of dragons, is with us today. Sven Martin is chief creative officer at Pixomondo in Frankfurt. He joined Pixomondo in 2008, where he has since implemented a strong creature and character animation pipeline. Sven was brought on the HBO series Game of Thrones in season 2, where he remained until the 8th and final season. His time on the groundbreaking show won Sven 2 Emmys, 3 Visual Effects Society statues, and 2 Hollywood Post Alliance Awards along the way. With over 16 years of experience in the visual effects industry, Sven Martin has worked with some of the top filmmakers in the world, including J.J. Abrams, Zack Snyder, Jon Favreau, Martin Scorsese, Lars von Trier, and Philip Stölzel. His work with Steven Spielberg on the director's acclaimed Bridge of Spies earned Sven his 4th VES nomination. Let's take a look at some of his work. Welcome with me here at the highlights of FMX, Sven Martin.
Thank you, Volker. Good to see you again. So thank you very much for having me on the FMX highlights, especially kind of in these days where we have to do this all from home. Just want to say kind of the reel we just saw is, of course, nothing which I did personally. Kind of this is actually from the talented artists from Pixomondo throughout the world, so all the different offices are doing incredible work. And actually, I found it very interesting that the majority is actually episodic work. So it gives us an idea how the landscape has changed, especially for visual effects, where we've been working on television series much more than on feature movies which come to cinema. This is kind of very interesting.
Interesting to understand. And I assume most of your colleagues and the others in the satellites are working from home at the moment.
Yes, at the moment we are all working from home. Beside the animators, they're actually in the office, so it's great. So when, let's say, I go into the office once a week to have a call or something like that, to see some real people, because it works quite good. Actually, I was surprised to see how smooth the transition was from the office work to the work from home. But I'm actually missing my 3D colleagues, just seeing them on as flat 2D representations on a monitor. It's just not the same.
Not the same, even though it looks like you have a nice home office setup from judging from your background.
Actually, that's the only area I have, because I'm in the my daughter's room, so she allowed me to have a little corner. So I had to squeeze in all my stuff in this one cupboard there, and the rest is all hers.
Okay, Sven. Can you tell us a bit about your path to animation, computer graphics, and visual effects? So I assume you were playing Dungeons and Dragons as a kid?
Actually, not really. I remember that during school time, we played something similar for a short time. But I was always a big fan of mystical creatures and special effects in general on movies. I remember very well being a kid that I was fascinated by classical movies like The Thief of Baghdad or the original Clash of the Titans with all the stop motion and puppets. And I was just something I wanted to know more of. And of course, films like E.T., I think that was my first feature in cinemas, live action feature, did influence me a lot. Alien, of course, Star Wars still is. I remember very well that when I saw Jurassic Park in cinema, I was so blown away. And I knew right away, this is what I want to do. And somewhat at the same time, I saw on television, it was a little on a third program, about the Film Academy. It was just mentioned quite briefly, 5 minutes or something like that. So they showed that there's actually a school, a university, an academy where you can study film effects, animation in Germany. So from that moment on, I knew, okay, this is what I want to do. And I tried to do a good kind of movie to be accepted there. And luckily, I was accepted.
So yeah, who would have guessed? But your final year project, which was finished in 2003, was called Ritterschlag, Night Games. And yeah, who would have guessed? But dragons play a central role in that film. Do you have some material and insights you can share with us from that time?
Yeah, actually, it's so interesting. I would not have guessed that I will ever speak about something which is, I don't know, 18 years old. I really had to dig into the archives to find something. It was interesting, kind of this time at the Film Academy, at the Animation Institute. It was a group of students. We all applied to do visual effects. And I know that 1 year after us, kind of they all wanted to do Pixar animated movies. So there was kind of a gap between, or a change of what we all wanted to do at this time. And Ritterschlag, I think, was something for me where I wanted to do both or to combine both animation, animated movie, but also with a little bit more realistic approach. Of course, realism is a little different meanwhile. But yeah, let me show you some examples. It was quite interesting. I found these pictures and I was surprised actually that this whole part is more or less still how I'm working today. I still prefer these paperboards, storyboards, concepts on the wall, which are constantly kind of influencing the daily work. These kind of countdowns, how many days are left to a deadline. So even in university, it was always a run against the deadline. But of course, you can see the monitors were much larger. And that was the time where we moved over from the SGI workstations to PCs, which was quite interesting. Technology-wise, the Dragons and how we did, or how I did the Dragons at this time was NURBS. I think no one's using NURBS anymore. Polygons was not the way to do it at this time. So this is a screenshot of, I think, Maya 4.5 with the facial control system and the NURBS patches to keep it fast. I remember that we also tried to do some first global illumination. We didn't use it later on the movie because it was just too expensive, but at least it was quite nice to see how an image could influence the lighting or actually do the lighting. This was a typical texture patch, and with NURBS, you can see everything was very nicely quadratic. It looks a little different than a normal polygon texture map today. But yeah, it was fun to do. Was fun to do. It was Sebastian Frey and myself. So we actually have been a core team of two doing all this. And but with more and more shots, or kind of at a certain point, we knew we can't do it just with the two of us. So all the fellow colleagues did jump in and help out. And it's still great to see kind of how many of these are super successful in the industry. And recently in LA, I met some of them again. A lot of them are living in Hollywood in LA. So it's great that this group meets here and there again, and the names are still powerful names in the industry. This is very nice to see. So you can see here, it's still a classical approach, starting with a storyboard, a quick scribble, and then on the other side, the final result. And I remember that we tried to, actually we didn't make it complicated because we wanted to, but because of the different people working on it, we had to combine already different packages. So it was animation of Maya and the rendering, but the backgrounds have been done in Lightwave with subdivision surfaces, very popular at the time. Actually, I have no idea how Lightwave is doing at the moment. And we also did backgrounds in Max, and I think maybe the Fog, not quite sure. So we had three different software types and we had to combine them in Digital Fusion, which was the compositing software, still pipeline-based or node-based. So very interesting. And the big challenges have been how to put hair on the princess, for example, which was Maya Fur at this time, because long hair was not really doable, or at least not for us as students. So yeah, we tried to put everything in what we liked during the day, and came up with this little short.
Yeah, thanks a lot for letting us know. I think for those interested, you can look up Ritterschlag, Night Games on YouTube. And I found this SD version, so you can see the full movie. But maybe still related to Ritterschlag, another question. So when you 2003 is when you finished, and I guess it took you 1-2 years, something like that. So when you look at the tools that you have at hand today, cloud computing, lots of resources, what would you say is the biggest advancements compared to back to 2003?
I would say what you see is what you get. So actually, I'm still fascinated how, and again, even before, kind of how they did Jurassic Park, and we have been already in a better situation. So of course, we could see a little bit in the viewport and track and have at least a gray shade, something to work with. How much more information you get meanwhile in real time on your computer, and I think this definitely helps because it's a big time saver. You don't spend time on waiting for an image to render, so you have much more creative freedom to find the right lighting angle or camera position, stuff like that. What we do in the real world as well, because the real world is absolutely real time, and you can run around and point your camera on different angles on your object and try different lighting situations. And I think this helps to make the image better. And you don't stop working on it just because you're running out of time. I think that may be the biggest advantage within these 18 years.
Good. Let's move on now to the Game of Thrones project and the work that you're most famous for on dragons and creatures. We've prepared a clip that we want to share with you, and then we'll talk about Game of Thrones.
Thank you.
Sven, can you tell us how you first got involved in Game of Thrones and the dragons?
That's actually a fun story, and because it connects to the Film Academy, actually. So at this time, I've been at Pixomondo already in Frankfurt, and we were working on some creatures for 2012 for the Roland Emmerich catastrophe movie. And in LA, the Pixo supervisor was Anna Gombosch, which is a fellow student of mine. So we've been together at the Film Academy. And he was working together with Steve Kalbeck. He's a visual effects producer on Game of Thrones for since season two. So these two knew that kind of I'm very much into characters and creatures and stuff. And it seems that the work on 2012 was quite successful. So when they came on board of Game of Thrones 2, Rainer did remember that I also have kind of a special a love for dragons. So, and this is how he gave me a call and asked if, hey, you want to do dragons? And actually, I had no idea what Game of Thrones is at this time. I haven't had read the books. I actually just wanted to do kind of the dragon stuff. That was always fascinating me. And a lot of artists in the company kind of were already fans and, oh my God, it's great. We work on Game of Thrones. And Pixomondo at this time was the only vendor. So every office was working on it. And I haven't seen Game of Thrones, I think, or maybe first time 2 years later or 1.5 years later, because after we finished season two and I didn't want to watch it right away, because when you're working every night and every hour on it and you've just finished it, I felt that I wanted to enjoy the story as it is, like a normal audience, and not seeing all the technical stuff we just kind of worked on. So, but when I started to watch it, I was hooked right away. So I could completely understand why Game of Thrones has so many fans, and from young to an older audience, kind of people loving it, even not loving fantasy stories overall. I totally can understand, and I enjoyed it until the very end.
Interesting. And were you involved in the whole design process as well?
Actually, that was the most fun part. So when Rainer did come on board, he sent us a paint over he did of one of the dragons from the season one, because he wanted to have a more gritty version, a little darker version. And we got some references like shimmering oil and some lava crust. And based on these ideas, we did our first dragon model. The model was done by Dan Katcher. He's a traditional sculptor from LA, so he was working from the LA office, and so we had our synthesis, every 2 days, whatever, and discussing ideas and changes. And actually Dan stayed on board. So when Joe Bauer came on board from season three on, we more or less kind of started to design or to think about ideas of the dragons while we were still working on the final shots of the previous season. So that was always the most creative part, I felt, especially at the beginning, because Joe and Steve gave us some first hints what the dragons might be doing in the next season. So there have been no scripts yet. And so we sat together, also not personally, but via Skype, playing around with ideas. So what are the new features for the next season? And Joe is great in giving lots of references. So actually all the ideas of Drogon are coming from the real world. So textures, the frills, for example, starting from season three, are taken from a frilled lizard. So we always try to keep it as natural as possible and not over-designing it. And not only from the real world, Joe gave us references, also from movies. So when it's about animation, for example, of course, we study a lot of real animals, but I'm just bringing it up because Phil Tippett will be with the FMX next time. And his work on Dragon Slayer was actually big influence. So this is his kind of famous Go Motion puppet. And when the dragon is recoiling, this was a shape Joe liked a lot. And I was also a big fan of Phil's work. And so it was, a perfect reference is just what we wanted to transport into Game of Thrones 2.
Yeah, interesting. I assume that's not always the case with creature work, that you're involved so creatively.
That's true. It depends very much on the project. So it depends on when you're involved. Very often, and it's getting more and more, that the visual effects crew is involved quite early with the first scripts. And I especially like this close collaboration between the departments. So special effects, what can be built for real as a set piece, where do visual effects have to take over? So this creative round of where does it make most sense to do in which department, and is what I very much love about filmmaking. But of course, when you have such a big production like Game of Thrones, there are lots of people involved. So Joe and Steve and Adam, Jason on the core production from Game of Thrones, they have a fantastic team of data wranglers and on-set supervisors. So, we were happy and very lucky and glad that we could also kind of bring in some own ideas, especially during the design process.
We have a community question that I think fits quite well into the whole topic of dragon creation. So Juan Sebastian Pacheco, he would like to know, how do you get an approach to animal autonomy as a beginner, especially for rigging aspects for mythical creatures?
Yeah, it's a very good question, because we actually kind of did ask ourselves exactly the same thing. So as we started to work on the baby dragon, we wanted to really build the model from the inside out. So we started with the skeleton, and right away we recognized that what we could fit into the hull is maybe not really the skeleton of a flying creature, because the anatomy is something different. So you have a much bigger breastbone, for example, because there has to be room for the muscles which are driving the wings. So actually we tried to augment the shape over the seasons more and more to make them a more believable flying creature. So we made the wings larger, and we used references from birds, so bird skeletons, of course, for the skin it's lizards, alligators, so you can actually combine it from all these different animals. The only thing what we always try to do is, as I mentioned before, not over designing them, because we knew that the overall approach of Game of Thrones was displaying the world very realistic. And so they decided to shoot on location a lot. So it's very much everything shot for real wherever possible. So of course there have been big set builds, but also outside, and the costumes and how the props and everything comes together is very realistic, and we didn't want it to fall out. So being with a fantasy creature, which maybe looks cool, but is not really kind of living in this real world. And we knew that the dragons had to be very close to the actors in direct interaction. So we always wanted to keep this reference to the animal world from the look, but also very much in the animation. Mm-hmm.
So looking at reality and physics probably is something that Juan might follow up doing is in his education and career, maybe.
Absolutely, yeah. I always can tell this fun story because at a certain point in season two, I really wanted to understand how the wings, for example, move. And we went to the supermarket and bought that chicken and put it on the table in the office, and all the animators and riggers kind of were standing around it, and they all had to pull on these little wings. Of course, a chicken is not a perfect flying reference for sure, but how the wing structure and how the bones work and where all the restrictions are is still very much like on a big bird. So, and actually we learned a lot of that. So what are the angles, how the wing moves, and for also the neck, that the neck rotation point is not somewhere on the top, so, but of course deeper in the body. So where is the neck rotating? All that stuff was actually quite interesting to learn from that real dead animal.
Can you say something about the team size for creating the more sophisticated rigs?
The rigs actually are done by one rigger.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
How many animators?
That depends on. It depends because working on a series, of course, you have these episodes. And sometimes you have an episode full of animation. Then maybe the next two episodes, it's maybe one or two animation shots. Then it's getting more again. So we have this constant up and down of team size. But I would say we have been normally around 5 to 6, maybe.
Okay, not too much. So you worked on a large number of international projects and with well-known directors. So can you explain a little bit the difference in working for episodic series like Game of Thrones, where directors change from season to season compared to feature film projects with only one director?
Yeah, the main difference is that the creative leads of in an episodic format are the showrunners. So they're mostly the executive producers, Dan and David in Game of Thrones case. And so they keep the creative vision together. So they overseeing everything. And from script to concepts and art direction. And so they are the ones who decide what will appear on screen, which is different on a feature film where it's mostly the director bring his vision on screen. So I would say this is the biggest difference. Of course, normally we don't talk to the showrunners directly because we have Joe and Steve and Adam on their side who are kind of passing all this information to us and the different vendors, and especially with Game of Thrones, where after all these years, the sheer amount of visual effects did increase and increase and increase with every new season. While we've been, as I said, the only vendor in season two, I think season 8 had 14 to 16 different vendors. So you can see it's a massive undertaking to keep all this together and make it a unique look.
Mm-hmm. And the biggest challenge in bringing the dragons to life?
The biggest challenge. Of course, we had to face every new year. We had new challenges. And that was mainly the interaction. So while the baby dragons had to just maybe sit or ride on Danny's hand or the shoulders, later on it was the other way around, that Danny had to climb on the dragons. And, that's always a little bit more complicated. to write and step and on something which is not there. So over the years, the technology did evolve a lot. So in the earlier years, it was mostly a styrofoam head which was used. Then there was a styrofoam bug which was hand controlled when she is climbing on Trogon. Then this bug got motorized and was steered by a pre-animation. So it was completely computer controlled, camera and the bug. And with the dragon getting bigger and bigger, this bug actually is massive. It's like a flight simulator, and the actors really had to sit very high, and it was not dangerous, but I would say challenging. So when you're afraid of heights and then you're sitting on this fast moving, a big colossus, I think it can be scary.
Yeah, maybe another audience question that fits in here quite well from Laurits. What is the most important technique to sell the audience that the dragon is real? Is it the animation, texturing, lighting, or the foundation, like the muscle shapes and bones?
It's the animation. Very much the animation. So this was always the part where we talked the most about. Of course, lighting and the texturing has to be look good, just to sit in the scene, and the compositing, which all brings it together. But especially the animation was tricky, because we didn't want it to humanize the dragons too much. That was also for Joe very important, that the dragons always are lizards, are animals, are creatures. Even they have to transport emotions, and that was this fine line of starting a little bit over the top, that we can all understand the emotions and read them in the eyes and how the mouth, how the nostrils move, and then dialing it back to a point where you can still see it, but more like when you watch your pets or your dog, for example, where you think you can see what he's thinking, but it's not a human face. And this fine line was actually the most important thing, I guess, on the work on Game of Thrones. And very often, and this is maybe also interesting, for certain areas or for certain animation parts, you can't find a good reference. So there are tons of free references, and I'm still amazed what is there for real in the wildlife, like picking up a goat. So we found an eagle picking up a goat from a cliff, which was something we had to do. But when it was more about, you know, the acting, when they are chained in the dungeon, for example, and Danny leaves them behind, it was a mixture of wild dogs maybe jumping into the chains, but at the same time it was this pain they are feeling and how they are screaming and shouting. And we did lots of rounds on this shot, I remember, until a point where we actually did go on our knees down, the animator and myself, and we put ropes around our chest, and we filmed ourselves, held by our visual effects producer at Pixomondo, Sabrina, and we filmed that and used that as a reference. And of course it was fun for Joe and Steve to see what we are doing, but it was also helpful for us, because the moment you are acting it out, you can better understand what you have to do to put the pressure into the chains, for example.
But no mocap involved, or?
No, there was no mocap involved. It's all keyframe animation.
Interesting. So Sven, you were VFX supervisor for Game of Thrones in season 8. Can you tell us about the tools that you used directly on set?
Yeah, season 8 was very, very interesting, especially when it's about techniques. So Joe came up with the idea that he wanted to have as much as visual reference for the directors as possible. And the directors have been the showrunners themselves. So it was Dan and David directing the final episode. And we were lucky to work on this very, very special sequence. This is kind of the spoiler area now.
I know.
Where something tragic. Most people should have seen it. So in the throne room, where we have this encounter of Danny, John, and Trogon, and it was a very special moment because it was not an action beat. Of course, there was some action involved and fire blasting and melting the throne, but it was also about these fine tones of Trogon realizing what has happened. So what we did based on first storyboards, we did a previous of the whole sequence, but not like you normally would do the previous for a sequence shot based. We built a 2-minute long continuous animation without any cheating, meaning we really had to squeeze Trogon into this very small and dense environment of the throne room, had to make it work that he's not constantly intersecting with columns and walls. And this information, after rounds of back and forth, we send it over to the third floor, they refined it, they gave it back to us. And this was actually then used on set. So we had the NCAM system for the camera tracking, which was also extending the throne room because it was only built in certain areas, especially the ground floor. But whenever we are looking up, this was a complete set extension. And then the animation of the dragon was fed in live into the camera. So the showrunners, Dan and David, could see on their monitor the live moving camera with Trogon moving as we did in the pre-animation, and could really judge the performance of the actors and Trogon together. And I think that was a great help. And luckily, that was kind of the only time where I could be on set with Joe and Steve, because all these years before, it was never possible because we all were always kind of working on the assets while they were shooting. So I'm very happy that on the last and final season and in this very special moment, I could experience life on set. That was great.
Awesome. So a typical virtual production approach, and I can understand that you appreciated it, but the rest of the team, did they find that solution helpful as well? The actors and the director and everybody?
I would say so. And I have to say it did run very smooth. So the team working on the NCAM was perfectly prepared. It was measurements before. So setting up a new shot was very quick. And of course, there have been changes on set during the shoot, but this is why it's made for, that you know that you can change stuff. Mm. And I felt, and I think everyone else, that it was a great help to see Trogon live, and that the camera operator not just had to pan to something which is not there or to a tennis ball on a stick.
I think there's some material you can share with us, right?
So we have seen the Game of Thrones making off from season 2, and I thought kind of having the both first and last making offs would be a good idea. So we can have a look to the making of season 8, and we'll see some of that stuff.
Wow, I think I have to start watching Game of Thrones again. Sven, any lessons learned from so much work on those series that you want to share with us?
Actually, what I learned is that preparation is really the key for good visual effects. Preparation is everything. And I think I've never met a team kind of what was better prepared kind of than Joe, Steve, and Adam. That was just amazing. So I think every vendor really did exactly what they needed. It was never a confusion. And I think this made it possible to bring all these visual effects in time on screen. And I think especially when you are on set yourself, of course, it's anyway very often that you have to react and come up with new ideas because something's changing. But personally, I always feel much more confidence when I know exactly what I have to do, when I'm prepared. And I think it's always kind of the best thing you can do because it might change anyway. But yeah.
So yeah, maybe we can talk a bit more about new technologies in general at Pixomondo and in your daily in your daily life. You explained the use of Encam tracking technology for season 8 for Game of Thrones, and in general, can you tell us more about technologies like these? An Encam system is not cheap to use. Are there other approaches where you bring in XR technology to do visual effects or previs?
Yes, and as you're saying, kind of it differs very much from project to project because, of course, all these tools are out there, but not every project can really afford it. So it's always this finding the right tool for the project and what is needed. It's a combination. So of course we do virtual scouting when you have very much a real environment, an unreal environment. So it's a great help when you really can stand in the room and do your camera positions. This was done actually on Game of Thrones 2 before the throne room was built. So that was done by the third floor. You can use real-time technologies like the Unreal Render Engine or Unreal Engine to create movie clips. So Pixomondo in Toronto did the Star Trek shorts completely in the engine, and we're using the engine especially for previs, for camera angle finding. But when you're on set, one little example, let's say when it's a European or a German production, very often it would be great to have an Encam system. But when it's a smaller production, like an episodic format, then there's still not the money for it. So what we did from the commercial sector, we actually had an iPad app, which was mostly meant for virtual scouting so that you don't have to really go on location in, let's say, downtown LA. So you can do it from home and find the right angles where the car's driving by. We used that on set of two German productions. You can show you a little clip here. This was a musical, so it's more stylized. But even it's stylized, you have to understand where your ship, for example, is. And this is running on a normal iPad, and so we had our ship in the right scale and could see where it is and how much it extends in all directions, which was very helpful because when it's just a green screen or some reference buildings, it's very hard to see where it really is, because especially when it's about very large objects. Another example is here. So we used the same app again for Bauhaus. Because we couldn't shoot on the real location of the university because it was under construction, it was a massive green screen backlot set in Babelsberg, and we only built the entrance, but we had buildings on all sides, so in the main angles. So it was important to see what do we see from which angle, and interesting wise, these buildings, when you're right in front of them, are very high. So without the check, I'd say we would have possibly kind of not hit the right angles. So here are some examples. As you can see, when you're looking up, we had to find a specific window, stuff like that. And that was possible with the, let's say, very cheap help of this iPad app, which gives enough information to understand where all these buildings are. And actually, what I realized, that directors like it very much. So right away, when they can see the final product, even in a low-res version, kind of they grab the iPad, run around, and just do their viewfinding. And I think it also helps them to understand how the scale is of the elements you have to put in.
Interesting. And do you think you can give us an outlook what visual effects work would look like in 2025?
5 years from now. 10 would be maybe easier. So what is happening in 5 years?
2030.
I think there will be a big change of camera technology. So I think we won't use green screens anymore to put stuff behind people, because the cameras will be very high in resolution and will have depth data captured with the pixel information. So you always know exactly where everything is in the space. That might make kind of a lot of stuff much easier, because green screen can set up quickly, but then it's very often not the best green screen you can have. And when you do a lot of green screen pre-planning, it takes a while to set it up, and it costs also money. And I can tell you that DOPs don't like you for setting up green screens, because not just that their image is spilled with green color, it's also that you take them space where they can put the lights, because normally they want to have the lights everywhere, and then you bring up the green screen. And so it's, I think this will make stuff much easier when you don't have to set it up, especially during the shoot.
So the end of green screen, yeah, that would be awesome. Sven, recently, our students got an exercise. It was at the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic. They had to describe their golden future. How do you foresee your golden future?
Oh, the toughest question last. The golden future. I hope that I can still do movies and support directors with their vision, and that I can do this together with friends and a team of talented artists, because this actually makes work fun. I never felt this as a money job. It was always something I wanted to do because of the fun of doing movies and being part of a film team. And if I can combine this in a good balance with family life and enjoying what is beside movies out there, I think that would be a golden future for myself.
It sounds terrific. Well, thank you so much, Sven, for this interview and insights. We have a little surprise for you now. We picked a trailer from the history of FMX for you. It's a trailer from 2004 featuring a digital character that actually both of us used to work on. So we'll take a look at that now.
Flash fiction, facial animation. motion capture, mad painting, morphing, montage, extension, expression, exploration.
Well, thank you again, Sven Martin.
Thank you, Volker, for having me with you. And it was actually great to see you again. So even not live, but at least on this format. Thank you for having me.
Catch up at FMX next year. Hopefully we'll be all able to meet in person. I also would like to thank the audience for joining us tonight. And if you have any suggestions and comments about the highlights of FMX, just write us to highlights@fmxce. And we'll do our best to include your feedback in our future program. We will meet again on Monday, July 20th, 8 p.m. CET, when visual effects veteran and stop motion master Phil Tippett will be interviewed by animation student at Film Academy, Arne Hein. Stay healthy, stay safe. See you soon, and we see you in a few days.